challenge has been received. And the throw is good. Perhaps enough to Tony Woodcock. Here's his kick. And he's nailed it. And the All Blacks are the world champions for the second time. Bowden Barrett's got a heap of pace. He leads the charge.
Go, Bowden!
That's so damage!
That's the World Cup!
First team to go back to back.
Tēnā koutou katoa, good evening, welcome into the breakdown. Well, the All Blacks have been world champions three times, will it be a fourth in 2023? Now that the Southern Hemisphere teams have released their Rugby World Cup squads, we look at the competition, plus we've got the CEO of New Zealand Rugby, Mark Robinson, coming in to answer all the hard questions from this guy. He will have all the hard questions. And Jamie Joseph rejoins the Highlanders. Jeff Wilson, Sir John Corwin. No idea where Mills Muliaina is.
We're one short. We're one short, and he clearly didn't like the debate last week, so he's had a Sunday off.
Well, he said that after the show.
And
he
I think
said,
that's
I don't
your
like
fault.
Being Jason Ryan.
That's your fault.
It's not my fault. Why is it my fault?
It is. You sat beside him.
No, well, he went from backs to forwards. Like, he took the Jason Ryan thing way too serious. He started getting 22 forwards involved.
Well, it's just
he didn't like it at all, actually. He did not like it.
Just the two of you for at least 20 minutes, so no time constraints today. You've been down in Otago. Jamie Joseph coming back. Big news. Were you involved in that deal?
No, nothing to do with me, but great news for the Highlanders. And I would say that literally puts everyone on notice if you're at the Highlanders. The fact that we know who Jamie is and what he's done for the franchise, where he's coming from, and he wants to give back, but he also wants to be part of a successful franchise. So he's going to cast his eye over things. I think he'll have a break after the Rugby World Cup, JK, because he's been with Japan for a long time now. But I'd say early next year he'll come back into the fold. And the good thing about Jamie is he won't rush to making decisions. He'll come in, put his eye over things, and then go, you know what, here are some adjustments we can make to help the Highlanders compete.
Well, I think it's great for New Zealand rugby as well, because I think Jamie has the potential to be an All Black coach and the next All Black coach. I think he's ambitious. I think he's always been ambitious.
We haven't got the next one yet. You're talking about the one after.
But the decision to actually pick a coach from home this time from Super Rugby is really good. He's had his experience. He's coming home, and I think it's great. I think he's a real good rugby man. I'm pleased for your Highlanders, because you need something, son.
We've got some players.
You'll be happier now during Super Rugby.
Sure, that's next year.
Jamie will be really hard on his recruitment, because when I got back as a coach, he was ruthless.
Yeah. You were ruthless too. You got rid of me. Carry on. Let's
go. At the moment, though, the one thing he's got to look forward to is taking Japan to another Rugby World Cup. 26 days away from the opener between New Zealand and France. But South Africa have released their squad. And it really is the curious case of the Springboks. 33 players and three major ones that have been left out of Jacques Nienaber's team. No Hondre Pollard, no Lucanio Arm, and no Lud Diaga. All three of these players are currently injured. But there's nine players named as standby players, which include Arm and Pollard, who will travel to England with the team, to Twickenham, Jeff.
So we've found out.
You study, right? Like, you're a bit of a
well, I think this is important because we're going over there.
But I don't understand why you'd take nine people. Why wouldn't you? Like, why wouldn't you? If Pollard's going to recover, just name him in your side.
But so what they can do, and so just so you're aware, that these squads aren't official squads until they arrive in France the week of the tournament.
So why do you name them?
I think it's so you are comfortable, so you can train as a squad, you can prepare, but they're still in a position where things can change. And the most interesting thing he said is, we believe that both will have the potential to be fit and ready to go by the Scotland game.
That's
talking
game
about
one.
Hondre Pollard and Lucanio Arn.
So the opening test.
The opening game. So they're in recovery mode, but clearly he thinks they're going to be fit and available. I'm anticipating their squad's going to be very different when it arrives in France.
Why don't you name them? If we've named Brody Retallick, who is currently injured, why do you not name these two? Is it a game?
What sort of game is it?
What's your conspiracy theory, JK?
I just think you're trying to play. If you're trying to play a mind game, you need to look at your
It's
own
not a very good one, because you've almost given away what your intentions probably are. The fact you name four halves, that doesn't make
it.
A lot of sense.
But I think if you look at, I think, like, when you look at injuries, and this is, you know, you cross your fingers for all the players that don't get injured, but Pollard is a huge, huge guy for them, I believe.
Yeah.
I don't think they're the same rugby team without him. And I think that they're
kind of the same.
Yeah,
I think he's the same.
Exactly.
World class players.
I think they're both players, but I think Pollard, because of his position, right? I think for me, you would wait as long as you can. The same with Retallick. Outstanding. You know, you wait for those guys. They've been around long enough, they can come straight back into it. So
Look, I've said for a long time, I think a lot of the World Cup success is down to the way André Pollard controls their team and the way that they play the game. He takes it to the line, he's aggressive, he kicks well, he's good in the air defensively, really, really strong. All the things and characteristics they have across their team. And he's vastly experienced and delivers in big moments. So I look at them and you anticipate they're going to be part of it. I'm not surprised that they're playing these sorts of games.
What's he got? He's got a calf or something, isn't
he? Like, he's been out for 8 weeks already.
Yeah, and they're saying he'll
be ready.
And he's
training.
So he'll be in that squad.
So they just get rid of one of the halfbacks.
The halfback probably already knows.
Four of them. Yeah. Four halfbacks and two first fives have been named in that squad. That is what is interesting. As for the All Blacks, they've brought an extra player into their 33-man squad. Three players will go to the UK, but Josh Lord has been added in place of their hooker.
Bell.
George Bell.
Bell, yeah.
George
who Bell. Unfortunately has picked up a niggle.
An injury.
But clearly they want some cover in the locking position. They're taking players over like Brad Webber. Very similar, the fact that they know they've got a contest in front of them. Actually, the Springboks are playing two games, so they're covering a lot of players. I'd be interested to see the combination we put together here. I'm not surprised, because we had Lord. Now, you didn't, but Mills and I had Lord in the wider squad. So
I had him in my squad. What are you talking about?
Well, you did. You hadn't selected him, but you agreed to commit
the
to
our squad. The team's already been selected, and they're still arguing about their selections.
When Retallick went down injured, I said, Lord goes.
Yeah. And he is going. He's getting on a plane to go.
But I was surprised when they named the players to go and he wasn't named.
Yeah.
I felt that was interesting.
So why now has he been added? He was added after the initial three.
I have no idea. Possibly they think that Brodie might take a little bit longer, get him over there, get him into the line-outs, make sure he knows all the systems. Then if he comes home, they just float around in the UK, wouldn't you? Most of these guys, there'd be a team floating around the UK.
They don't come back and play NPC?
We want to keep them fresh. You want to keep them close. They'll probably go to Germany with the squad to prepare as well before they head to France. But there's a number of things that could happen in that test match at Twickenham that could change the landscape, because you just don't know. It's a contact sport. It's a contact game. So having those few extra players, I think, gives us a good indication of where they're at.
Who do you play?
Bit of everyone. I'll be interested in the fact, is it an official test match? Is it one of those ones where you might have a wider squad? Because ultimately, let's remember what this test match is. It's preparing for a Rugby World Cup. That's what you're trying to do. But
yeah.
I'll be fascinated.
Is it international rules? Otherwise, you just get everyone off at halftime.
Good thing is we've got the CEO, Mark Robinson, here. He can probably
ask him.
Yeah, we'll ask him.
Okay.
Or he's going to start feverishly getting on his phone right now and texting someone as he sits over there watching the show. So I'm looking forward to that, which will be great.
Yeah, the All Blacks, remember their opening game is against France, who have just wrapped up a two-match friendly series against Scotland. Is there any such thing as friendlies heading into the Rugby World Cup? Because the test this morning, Jeff,
so
ran superbly by Antoine Dupont, who has to be the world's best player right now. Do you stop that guy?
Yeah, I think when you look at what's happened over the last couple of weekends. Last weekend it was the others played. This weekend, most of the squads, the top guys went out there, and France, for about a 20-minute period, looked amazing. Yeah. But I was almost as impressed by Scotland, because it would have been quite easy for them to drift off this test match. They kept playing, and Finn Russell is world-class. They have a world-class first five. Scotland are dangerous. We know the pool they're going to be in, but I think what we saw that they're capable of in this game, and we've talked about it already, JK, this is a side that are going to give the Springboks and Ireland some trouble in their pool.
Finn Russell is a free spirit. I think he's one of those players that you actually can't play too organised for him, but all those around him just need to be ready. He's got real X factor. Scotland are a real interesting squad at the moment. I think they've done a great job. They put us under pressure last year in November. I think they're going to be... That's an interesting pool, that one. I think the French, if you can't choke Dupont down, and the interesting thing, he'll run early, so he puts the defence under pressure early, and so the defence, especially around the rucks, start waiting for him. Once they start waiting, he gets out to that second defender, Goldie, and there's all sorts of people running off him.
He is electric. His vision, his ability to look left and right and to make good decisions, and he's creative, and the defence stops because he is so dangerous. He created a couple of overlaps with ease this morning. Intermac was really good at 10. They were awesome. He's so good that his ability to actually kick the air out of the ball. This is one of the most bizarre things I've seen in a test match, because I wondered what Scotland were doing in the counter-attack. Because it wasn't... I thought, is he called a mark? He's like 15 minutes outside his 22.
Have you ever seen that before?
Not like that. Not mid-game, like mid-kick. So obviously, on impact, it's exploded. Wow.
I think the really interesting thing about the French and the Irish attack is they do use their nines as part of the attack. So you see Gibson Park, you see DuPont, they actually accelerate out, and they're accelerating out on an interesting angle. So they're not going forward, they're going across, but there's things happening off them, and that slows the defence line up. They're probably one of the, you know, those two sides, you've got to shut those halves down quick.
Just on Scotland, do they make it out of their pool? And if so, who do they beat?
So I've got a random. I think there's going to be they're going to end up on the same number of wins. I think there'll be an upset somewhere along the way. They could end up with three wins each out of their pool. That's quite possible. And all of a sudden, guess what? Bonus points. The margin of error and how close you get.
So just remind me
the number of tries. So four tries.
South Africa,
Ireland, and Scotland.
Scotland.
There you go. I'll throw that one out there now.
It all comes down to bonus points. Does Scotland get out of the pool for you?
No.
Emphatic.
He always is. What about England? Because England are on the other side of the draw and their captain is in a little bit of hot water. You can see him there highlighted in red. Owen Farrell has been around for a long, long time, but he continues to make the same mistakes, JK. He was red carded today for this high shot on the Welshman, Tane Basham. Yellow card that was upgraded to a red and he didn't come back on. Is he going to be banned for this?
He'll get three games. He probably should get 8 weeks because of his record. I think that's just lazy. I think he's been lazy there. I don't think there's a lot of intent in it. And he's just too high and lazy, right?
That's the guy who's just getting clocked in.
Yeah, no, I get that. I get that. But when you look at it, I don't think it's...
I think it's just lazy
and technically poor. His trouble will be that with his record, you'd probably think that they'd give him 4 to 6 weeks. But do we think you should do that World Cup year to the English captain?
Well, I'm interested
in the coaching. Make a decision, Goldie.
I'm interested in the coaching course.
3 or 6 weeks.
That he's done the last time that obviously clearly didn't work. And this is a repeated behaviour.
3 or 6 weeks.
Well, whatever decision they make on this case will have to stand, the president will have to stand in the Rugby World Cup. You can't make a decision now to get someone available. You give him 3 weeks and he's available, misses maybe the first game. You get him to the Rugby World Cup first match and someone
can
else does the same thing.
We should ring Sir Bill, Uncle Bill, and ask him if he can change that dumb rule of not letting a player come back.
The 20-minute one?
Yeah. Because only the fans are going to suffer and the nations that are spending a million.
I'm with you. I didn't see any intent from that, but it's poor tackle technique.
I get it. I get it. So 3 or 6 weeks?
Me?
Now, what would you give him?
For bad behaviour? Because it is repeated bad behaviour? It's just 6 weeks. You can't. If you give him the same as he got last time, that's absurd.
What did he get last time?
3 weeks in January.
Yeah.
For the exact same thing.
For exactly the same thing. So you get it, you say there's not much in it, but we're talking about one of our most biggest issues in the game is concussion that's talked about. Now, we know it's a collision sport, all of those things, and I don't want to highlight this, but if you set a precedent now, JK, if it happens in the first game and someone 3 weeks later is available for a quarter final, that's what you'll be saying on that, anytime you see it. So I think whatever they do here, and he's only got himself to blame, he's got no one else to blame. He was the guy that was responsible for the tackle. So I don't have a lot of sympathy. I feel for him because he's so close to Rugby World Cup, but he did it. And that puts England under pressure if
their
he can't
captain.
Play. Their captain.
Captain.
But also so influential. So much experience. He knows, and he can win. He knows how to win. Mm. Big mistake.
Should the best players be playing no matter what, JK?
Yeah, I think this is a really interesting case because, like Goldie said, he's had passed. Mm. I'd love to see him play. I think that... I'd also love for the World Rugby to change their decision and let players come back after 20 minutes if it's a red, just because...
They can be replaced, you mean?
Yeah.
They can't come back?
Yeah. Yeah, right? They can't come back but get replaced, just because I think we need to be more fan-centric. So from a health and safety point of view, yeah, I think you should get 3 weeks. Do I want to see them at the World Cup? Yes. I want every best player there.
Yeah.
Do I want games to be decided on a red card? No. That's why I'd love to see that come in, and so I should start a petition.
You love a petition.
Will you sign it?
You'll start drawing your stick figures again in terms of tackle.
Well, he has
the course he needed to see. That's the course he needed to go to.
Me teaching tackling.
Yeah, right.
Oh, well, Well, guess what? Australia have named their Rugby World Cup 33-man squad, and Eddie Jones has dropped some bombs. Yes, there is no Cooper and no Hooper. Michael Hooper, Quade Cooper have both been dumped. Will Skelton has been named as captain of the side. Vice-captain will be Tate McDermott. There are a lot of youngsters. 25 of the 33 have never been to a Rugby World Cup before. Australia are saying they are literally working backwards from 2027, the home World Cup next time, Jeff.
Yeah, this was the risk you took the moment you made such a late coaching decision. The fact that he came in at the end of last year, he doesn't know his players. He didn't know the group of guys he was going to be working with. And he's literally what had four tests, JK, to work out what he wants to take. And he spent a couple of test matches working that out. And they're definitely in a difficult position now because they have no clear backup 10 or with any sort of experience in this group. I think Michael Hooper's just in an unfortunate situation where I don't think he's the same player he was. For whatever has happened in the last 12 to 18 months, he's just not having the same impact on the game. And he's been one of their very best, one of their toughest players for a long, long time. I just don't see him having the same impact. And they did have options in the loose forwards. That's
that
the one thing they did have.
Test career, though, if that's the end for Michael Hooper.
It might be, but I won't remember him for this, for not making this Rugby World Cup squad, because I think some of the challenges he's been through, he's been world-class for them, he's put his hand up, have so much respect for him, but I haven't seen the best of him probably for 18 months. So.
But he's also injured.
He's carrying something.
Carrying an injury. Yeah, I mean, I think that he's been an outstanding player and, you know, if he's injured, not getting back from you know, certain stuff, I know he's had some mental health issues, then he's been a great player. And that for me, not the issue. I wasn't expecting him to make it because I thought he was injured and I haven't seen him. The Quade Cooper one is interesting for me, you know. Quade's been an amazing player for many years and I thought he probably needed to do a little bit more during the games that he played, especially coming off the bench. So I don't know if Eddie saw him come off the bench and thinking, I actually need something else. But when you sign your coach for 5 years and it's someone like Eddie Jones and you do have a home World Cup coming up and you're thinking, I'm going to get a young side, and that's what he's done. But the thing that I'm thinking about, does Carter Gordon, I mean, you and I spoke about that kick that he missed, you know. It was a pretty big kick he missed, Quade. So, I mean, does Carter Gordon now play every game?
I think he does. I think he has to. Because when you play as few test matches he's played, he needs to get as many minutes under his belt as he possibly can. I'll just go on Quade Cooper. His time is gone for me. In 2011, he was the guy for Australia. He got them to a semi-final. They've moved on and they've gone to a young face who I think is going to have a big future in the jersey. There were other players, though, Noah Lolasio, who had been given opportunities under Dave Rennie and who are now in the wilderness. Ben Donaldson's the guy that's got the responsibility for them. And he was named as a utility. I love Eddie. He invented another position. He named all the squad. There's backs and forwards, and we've decided we want two utilities. So he's putting the responsibilities on them. In saying that, though, as we said at the top of the show, JK, there could be, for whatever reason, a late change. If they see something, if they realise that they're not prepared, I don't know. But at the moment, he's taken a risk. He's put all his eggs in this basket. And I think it's, for now in the future, their best opportunity.
But what are your options? That's what I always think of.
Yep.
What are your options? He's obviously thought that bringing Quade on is not an option for him anymore. He's given him a few tests. He said that, you know, Carter Gordon is his number 10, so he's going to play him. So what do you want off the bench? Maybe it's not what Quade's been giving him off the bench.
So I just want to...
What do you look for off the bench? Either impact or experience, right?
Well, you're trying to get a balance of both, right? And the All Blacks have shown that as well. They're looking for that. I'm looking at it, and it was a great kick that Quade Cooper made down in Dunedin to tie the game up, and then he made the critical error, which led to the scrum penalty, which then cost them the game. And those are moments that you just can't have. You talk about experience. Those are moments you can't have from a guy who's played as many test matches as he's played. I think in the end, it was by his own doing, his own hand, so they needed to move on. I do want to look at some of the things, though, right? Look at the age of players and the average age of teams.
So,
and the average age of first fives in Rugby World Cup finals and the number of caps they're playing. Because I'm going the fact you can't just wander in with very little experience. And this is the pressure now that is going on Carter Gordon. Look, Grant Fox played one, that's 1987. You were part of that. That was a fantastic group of players and team you were with.
Yeah, I just watched that game today.
Yeah, I know. You looked traumatised.
Him and Michael Jones were player of the day for sure.
But if you go, Lynam played 48 caps. It's 27 years old. Larkham, 25. Johnny Wilkinson, 49 caps. Then towards the end, Stephen Donald and Aaron Cruden. But Butch James, Dan Carter, Andre Pollard, 106 tests, 41 tests. These guys are experienced, have spent plenty of time in pressure position. But the other one I want to talk about is the average age. And we talked about experience winning Rugby World Cups.
This is squad's age.
This is of the winning teams, yeah. The teams that played in the winning team. It's all what? It's about the average of 28. Yep. The last three squads, 28.5, 29, 28.3, 29 in 2003, which is that England squad. So the three New Zealand squads, you're looking at it, you want guys who have been there and done that. And I just think when you talk about average caps, it's just gone up.
You've obviously got no social life and you've studied this shit at home. But
no, I didn't. No. I got someone else to find the numbers for me. I just asked the question.
Can you tell me what the average age of this side is then?
26. The All Black squad that they've just named, the average age is 26.
26. So you look at Australia.
So on the stats, Aussie's got no chance.
I think it'll be very difficult with that group, with that team. It doesn't mean they won't do what Australian teams do, and we've seen it in the Football World Cup and we've seen it in the Netball World Cup, and when they go to World Cups, guess what they do? They compete and they are mentally tough when it comes down to it, and the Australian cricket team has shown that they are ruthless. They don't care how they go about it. I think as individuals, they're proud, they'll prepare, they'll go out and compete, and on their side of the draw, I think they'll be in a position to get to not just the quarterfinals, but find a way maybe to sneak into a semi. But for them to get through and win a title, I find it hard.
So if they're looking ahead to 2027, the next Rugby World Cup, this World Cup is a free hit then, JK. They can do no wrong. The coach stays, the players stay.
I think they're going in as underdogs. I think people have written both them and England off. More reasons to write England off than there are Australia. I think Eddie's doing his job. He's gone, this is what I'm doing. I'm going to get a group of players I can mould. They're young enough to do two World Cups. He'll firmly believe they can win. And I think if he continues to play, especially Carter Gordon, who for me, it's all there. He's just making some inexperienced mistakes, right?
How much better was he in 7 days?
Yeah.
From the difference from Melbourne to Dunedin, he was very much a different player, and that improved. Hence, he.
Why did you take him off then?
Well, the game was close, and you brought your experience on. You gave them the opportunity to take you home, and they didn't get the job done. So, you know.
Well, a few to a finish. We've got a new song to add to your record collection, JK, and I know it is a massive record collection. Te Mata Tini have gifted the All Blacks and New Zealand rugby a beautiful trilingual song. You'll hear some French, some English and some Te Reo Māori. Have a listen. Yeah, this is a beautiful song gifted to the All Blacks for their Rugby World Cup campaign. It's to bring fans from all over the world together to get them believing in the All Blacks and backing this brand. JK, as a lover of music, what do you think of that sound?
Yeah, that's me. Love that. Love Rob's glasses as well. He's styling those glasses. But yeah, I love things like that during the World Cup. Blare it out there.
We had a song in 99. The song, it went to number one for quite a few weeks, but then we lost. And that's been put into the wilderness. It was the
Neil Finn. Yeah.
It was great. It was really, really good.
Yeah.
Hopefully this gets
the same traction. You can go and listen.
Better traction because it goes in when
we win. Exactly. We win it and then that song goes absolutely gangbusters. Reo Hall, Rob Ruha and Te Kapahako o Te Whanau a Apanui. Coming up right after the break, we've got the CEO of New Zealand Rugby joining us live on the program. Mark Robinson, are you going to go easy? Are you going to be nice, JK?
Of course I am. I'm always nice.
There you go. Don't go anywhere. You won't want to miss it. His letter from the King. Joining us, Mark Robinson, CEO of New Zealand Rugby. Thank you so much for your time once again. Pleasure. That'll be pretty close to your heart.
Oh, it's amazing. Yeah, we had the chance to send a gift and a message down to Roy on Friday and heard back later in the evening. It was a tremendous day, apparently. So, yeah, a little message from myself. I think Bodie gave a message from Napier, where the All Blacks were at the time. when he recorded it, and amazing day. Phenomenal person, great, very proud All Black, great Taranaki and representatives for a really successful era, and has given a huge amount to the game at all levels, especially the community level.
So you've listened to us go on about the Rugby World Cup, talk and chat, and we're not going to get your thoughts on that, but I want to talk about the fact clearly the last year has been a challenge, but they've risen to the challenge, this All Black team, and all of a sudden we've found this wave of enthusiasm, support. You'd have to say confidence, because things are going really, really well, but there's a lot of stuff that's happening off the field, which has, I think, been new and exciting, and we've certainly seen a level of engagement with the All Blacks. Maybe we haven't experienced for a while. Has that been a big part of the plan?
Yeah, I think through the back end of last year, obviously the team and the organisation put a lot of effort and thought into how we could really connect with the nation and our communities in the lead up to a World Cup, and Foz and Sam from the team and management side certainly led a lot of that. And from the organisational standpoint, we were, you know, more than happy to support. So the bench campaign we've seen right around the country, you know, 26 benches going to all of our unions and members right across all the different communities, amazing sights and scenes, and phenomenal emotions tied into that. So the concept behind that really was one of sort of giving back. And, you know, traditionally in World Cup years, there's been a call to arm to support the All Blacks. Well, I think the All Blacks and New Zealand rugby really wanted to make sure that we were supporting each other. You know, the communities in New Zealand's been through some challenging times of late. And we were able, with this concept of the bench, to be able to say, well, we're backing our communities, and it provided the opportunities for the communities to back the All Blacks as well. So a real feeling of reciprocity, you know, giving back to each other. And as you say, it seems to have connected really well with people right around the country.
I think last time you're on, Robbo, you know, the Silver Lake deal had just landed. You're probably now a year in. What's the difference been for you with that injection of cash? Has it changed the way you're managing things? Has it been easier?
Well, we did... the most critical thing initially was for the investment to go into the membership of the game, right across the game. So we always said that the Silver Lake opportunity provided us the opportunity to shore up the balance sheets of all rugby entities right across the country, and then in time create long-term value and grow revenues. So the first thing's been achieved. We've invested about $38 million right across the game into the provinces, Māori Rugby Board. So that's helped shore up that space, and we've heard some great stories back as to how that money's being deployed in different settings. Some sort of facility upgrades, some investment into people on the ground, being able to help encourage participation. So that's really been positive. On the other side, in terms of long-term growth, the board's been established, New Zealand Rugby Commercial Board. Obviously a new CEO appointment just been announced very recently. And the strategy work we're developing is coming to, you know, being close to sort of being finalised too. So, you know, that'll take a little bit more time, but we're really excited and committed and you know, certain that's going to produce dividends in time.
Just on the finances, you've led us there. So the Rugby World Cup, how important is it to win the Rugby World Cup from a financial standpoint for New Zealand rugby? What would winning it mean for New Zealand rugby?
Oh, look, I think we're more focused. Obviously, it would be incredibly positive for rugby in New Zealand and really positive for, the All Blacks and the organisation more broadly. But I think, you know, winning across all of our teams in Blacks on a consistent basis is really what we focus on, you know, on a day-to-day basis. So, obviously, the All Blacks, the Black Ferns, our Sevens teams are absolutely critical and build that whole... sense of success right across the game for us is really critical. And I think the other thing we focus on too is how we sort of conduct ourselves and perform off the field as well. So, you know, they're all critical things. There's no doubt it would be extremely positive, but, you know, our commitment to winning in teams in Black is something that we live every day.
The Bunnings NPC for me, Robbo, seems to be not in great shape. I think that there's no one turning up. It feels like there's less and less interest out there. I mean, is that a sustainable competition?
Well, it's something we're working on all the time with our stakeholders. So clearly we saw some really positive trends as it related to broadcast and streaming with Super Rugby, but also some, you know, challenges as it related to in-game attendance. And NPC for many years now has had some challenges. We've been working with, you know, the provinces around. So, you know, as we speak, there's work going on as to what the future of that competition could look like. We just have to keep, you know, working really hard with all the relevant people, the RPA, the provinces themselves, as to what the future of that competition could look like. At the time of, I guess, you know, talking about the Silver Lake deal, we recognised that there was some, there were three key things in the game we were concerned about. One was the financial sustainability. Two was engagement, to your point, of what was happening in our major competitions. And three was participation across the game. And so, you know, there are three things that we've highlighted we need to address, and we're going to go about work, continue to work on that.
But what you're trying to address here is sustainability. I mean, as it stands right now, given all of the investment you're having to make across all of the layers and where the pressure's coming from, is it, if we continue doing the same thing, is it sustainable?
No, we've said, you know, regardless of... you know, the Silver Lake injection of capital into the game we've just talked about, the model we've got at the moment is not fit for purpose. So we're working really hard with all the different people involved to make sure we can try to address that. But it'll take time. It'll take, as we've seen in recent times, it'll take, you know, obviously the time to build consensus, build understanding of what's possible, and that takes time. But those trends we're facing now are not new, and we've just got to, you know, work through it with people.
I've got a voce di corridoio.
Here we go.
Not a good one. Well, so for me, the NPC sides are the community game. They should be in charge looking after clubs, looking after schools, looking after all that. I've heard, voce di corridoio, that the union's got $1 million, most of them, and three or four unions have actually spent it on building a rugby team, a senior rugby team. So if they're going to spend that extra money on a rugby team that is actually in a competition that might be not what it used to be, isn't that just taking money off the communities?
Well, the Silver Lake, so the NPC unions, you're right, JK, each received $1 million. The use of that went into threefold, effectively. One, a few of them had debts they were holding to New Zealand Rugby, so they were paid off immediately. Two, there is a reserves policy that we have an agreement with the provinces that they will meet, so that had to be met. And then thirdly, they worked with us to develop strategies to invest in the community game. So that is what the $1 million there was focused on doing. And the updates we've had so far would reflect that that's where that money went. But, you know, it's clear there's been different reports and speculation around, you know, the financial health of the provincial unions and the money being spent around, you know, their leading teams and management staff, and that's something we're obviously concerned about. We just have to keep working with them around trying to create a model that is more fit for purpose, as I said before.
Couple of coaching announcements this week. Brand new head coach for the Sevens program, Tomasi Thama, and Jomi Joseph returning back to New Zealand. How do you compete with the yen? How did you get him back to New Zealand? And were they hard conversations given the fact he went for the All Blacks job next year and missed out?
Well, firstly, we're thrilled for Tomasi. You know, it's an amazing opportunity for him with Clark moving into the Hurricanes, and you know, we're really excited for Tomasi. He's got a huge amount of talent in that seven space, well respected by the players. So we're excited for what he can do in Olympic year next year, and also delighted to have Jamie coming back into the fold. You know, clearly he's got really strong connections into the deep south, and you know, there were some great conversations with people in that part of the world, along with ourselves. And it's just phenomenal for New Zealand rugby to have someone of that experience, hugely respected right across the game. And I think it'd be great for Super Rugby as well. You know, it brings the talkability of the fact we're bringing world-class talent back in that will have a big impact on our emerging talent and our leading talent. So great all round.
I love the commitment you're making to the Highlanders. I really do. I mean, we should see more of that, and you carry that on. I want to just then...
I'd ask the partners for more money.
Eh? Of course you would. Of course you would.
The owners, you mean?
No, the don't point at me. I don't know what you're pointing at me for. No, I want to talk about players, though. I want to talk about players because clearly next year it's one of the rare occasions that we will go out there with probably not the best All Black team available for the All Black jersey. When you've got quality like a Richie Moanga, a Shannon Frizzell, you know, is there a world that you see that we are in a position that we can, on isolated occasions, pay what some of these players are actually worth? When you talk about trying to have success in teams in black, and then we've got a lot of even Black Ferns players who are playing overseas, yeah, in different competitions now, all of that, is there a world you see where you are generating enough revenue that we're in that market and we are able to keep the players we need?
Well, I think we've shown over the last few years that we can do that. We have to be creative with some of the sabbatical arrangements we've looked at. You know, the remuneration for players, and especially in the likes of France and Japan, is, as you know, significant. So it's not always about being able to meet that top dollar, Goldie. You know, there's a lot of work that goes into having great environments, what we talked about before, leading coaches, great competitions, that chance to perform on the world stage, and we're going into amazing parts of the world with our teams in black now that we've not gone to before. You know, more connection with Japan, for instance, North America, you know, other ideas into parts of Europe. So there's a lot to be said about playing on those stages in black jerseys, and aspiring to be, you know, in one of the, I guess, the, some of the leading teams of the world through our teams in black. So, you know, we can't always compete absolutely with the money. We'd like to think in time, you know, we can keep growing our revenue so that we will be able to be more and more competitive. But there's a lot of other things we can provide as well, apart from the remuneration that goes into retaining people.
Can I just ask how far apart we are? Let's just use some figures. If we're paying people 100, are they getting 250? Is the difference? I mean, times it by two or three.
I think they're probably all different, JK. I wouldn't get into it. Sometimes there's, you know, a significant gap, and maybe it's not as large, and it might be more about where the player is at and ready to move or not. So, you know, I probably wouldn't speculate there. But, you know, clearly there's a lot of interest in those two markets and competitions I've talked about before. That you know, appetite for Kiwi players is strong. But I would say also that we're seeing, and this goes to, you know, the fact that it's not just challenging here in New Zealand with, you know, financial sustainability of the game. We're seeing more players out of the UK especially go into Japan now. It's clear, you know, some of the challenges and some of the competitions such as the URC and the Premiership in England are also having challenges, and therefore probably for the first time ever we've seen more and more players gravitate to Japan, especially from that part of the world.
You mentioned taking tests to other parts of the world, Japan, Europe. Last time you were on, you talked about Fiji. Is that test for next year confirmed in the Pacific yet?
We're still working on that, Kirsty. So, you know, we'd love to be able to do something like that. It just takes a little bit of time to work through. As we said last time, the two games against the English and one against Fiji at home, and then we'll just see how we go with that other match.
We went another year where we didn't win the World Under-20 competition. Haven't won since 2017. And saying that, there wasn't a tournament for a few years, given COVID. Any concerns about the pathways right now in terms of creating, if we can't keep players, the depth that we need in critical positions? And is it something at the moment you guys are looking at and is under the microscope?
Oh, look, Goldie, every campaign we have with a team in black, we are looking at really, really seriously. You know, they're heavily scrutinised, and the under-20s is no different. So we'll get an update from our team, you know, very, very soon as to what we can do better there. Pathways and development is clearly one. You know, coaching and resources around the team, another factor that, you know, we'll look at. I think time and campaign, you know, our opposition that we're playing against are in campaign for much longer, having many more fixtures than we're having. We've obviously signed off with our Sanzar partners on the Sanzar Under-20 competition for next year, the Rugby Championship Under-20s, which is a great development, and that, along with some other tweaks we make in our campaign, you know, we hope we can certainly provide the players with the best opportunity going into tournaments.
They cost money, though. I mean, all of a sudden, when you talk about these layers that you're talking about, everything you add, it costs money. It's expensive to run these programs. That's why I look at it, you talk fit for purpose. You've got some tough decisions that need to be made coming forward.
Yeah, and we know we've got a lot of work to do with, you know, on the coach development side too. At the moment, there are over 120 athletes and coaches tied up in the MLR in the USA. Now, that didn't exist a matter of a few years ago. We know the attraction to Japan we just spoke about. So that's playing talent, coaching talent, and some of the, you know, strength and conditioning analysts, all that sort of thing, where there's a drag on our resource. So we've got to continue to work really hard in that space. We've, you know, pointing at the moment around the coach development side, 5 regional coach, high-performance coach development managers who will work more closely with those emerging coaches and make sure they've got good support wrapped around them. We'll look to be more involved in alignment, you know, of the coaching pathway through Provincial Union and to Super Rugby. And that's come out of looking at, you know, the things we're doing at present and acknowledging they've got to get better.
Is Sanzar still Sanzar? I mean, when you talk about South Africa, are they going to come back into our Super game ever?
Oh, look, into Super, I think it's tough, JK. You know, the world, you look at travel now and what's happened there, you know, that would be tough. But great conversations with them happening on the, as it relates to the international front, around Rugby Championship, the under-20s. You know, we're looking at, you know, women's rugby in the future, obviously. So all of those things is great and really positive conversations. I'm meeting them when I'm up in London next week, and we're talking about the future of opportunities together with New Zealand and South Africa, so really strong.
You rang me about twice, you text me 3 times. You were very concerned coming on. You wanted to be well and truly prepared for what we're going to talk about. and you're smiling at the end of it. So I think that's important. The
fact survived.
That, yeah, you survived. It wasn't that hard, you know.
Goldie, I always like to have an idea. I got a couple of random ones that I wasn't expecting, but that's all cool. Yeah. All fair game.
What are you looking at me for? They're coming from that direction. When do you head north?
I go on Sunday, and I've got the week in London. Looking forward to that. That Springboks game in Twickenham, and a lot of work going on up there with different partners and potential partners. Down to Germany with the team, and then up to Paris as well for the opener, and then coming home for a bit, and then heading up later in September. Busy time.
The business end.
Yeah.
You're a very busy man, and we always appreciate you making time to answer these questions and coming to talk to the fans directly as well. Thank you so much for your time.
Thanks.
Travel well, and we'll see you up there.
Thanks.
Thank you so much. Mark Robinson joining us there from New Zealand Rugby. Don't go anywhere. We're going to continue the chat about our NPC and FPC competitions with Taylor Johnson right after this.
But it's there for Yatini Nanosatoru, dancing on his feet, and he's just out, he scores the try! Sweeping it away, nice tip on, Steinmetz, now working wide, Ratkovic, inside ball again, McCook, she's got some chasing from Blake, to the line though, Kelsey McCook over. Trying to chip it through, and so connected by Talbot, and Wakano, Nora Troy under the post.
Savage now, great break from the first five, and they go wide. It's going to be a try, Kerry Johnson.
Jeff Wilson is the winner. Look at that form. Terrible.
All out the back door. Kanifi. And now James O'Reilly down the right edge. Beautiful ball back on the inside.
Welcome back to...
Did I just see you throwing a gumbo?
I'm not sure how that's a highlight.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. What? But it looked like a used gumbo.
What's that?
Look at the arm swing as well. That's some good form there.
When you haven't thrown anything for about 3 years, other than my toys, because my toys get thrown all the time.
Look how serious you are.
Yeah.
Did you really want to win that?
Yeah, I did. You're either a winner or a loser sometimes.
And did you win it?
There was five other losers.
You know how competitive
I got a gust of wind. Gust of wind blew it forward.
Welcome back to the program. Welcome in to Taylor Johnson. We're talking NPC and FPC. It's rocks and diamonds in this competition that we've seen over the last 5 weeks. But at the end of the day, this is where our future of New Zealand rugby lies, is in this provincial competition. Taylor, you've seen it all. And we've just heard a startling admission from the CEO. This competition, as it stands, is not fit for purpose. What have you been seeing from both competitions?
Oh, it's been really interesting, right? Because remember, this year there's no premiership, championship, no odds and evens, everyone's in the same pool. And it's not sustainable because you look at the teams like Auckland, Canterbury, Tasman, Wellington, from 1 to 23, they have Super Rugby players. If you get Manawatu, South and Northland, you know, at best they're lucky to have five. And it's not sustainable for the fans or for the players because, you know, you're sending players out there against some of the best. And yes, iron sharpens iron, but it's a tough gig, and you're not going to get any better when you're not, you know, in those right environments.
But wasn't it always like that? Like, when we played, it was very much like that. There was this Auckland, and there was Canterbury, and I remember when I first went to Otago...
Salary caps back then?
Couldn't afford him. We got their whole team. But I, all of that, JK, to me, I think it used to be like that, and that's the challenge.
I disagree.
It was reflective.
I disagree. The difference was, besides the Scarfies, who most of you went down to study, back and probably pre-professionalism, you didn't import players. And this is one of the things that I've got. If you spend your money on community, then you shouldn't have to import players. Or we go the other way and we have a draft. Because there's no way that a team should have 23 super players and another player doesn't. And I guess the challenge on the women's game is now we've got league to contend with.
Yeah, well, the interesting thing too with the crowds is, yeah, Southland doesn't have the most Super Rugby players, but, you know, you're from Southland, they have the best crowds. I've never seen a poor crowd at Southland, even when they were, you know, on a record losing streak. People were turning out in numbers, and that's because it's the best ticket in town. And, you know, rugby's competing with everything else as well. But you're so right, the NRLW is really hurting the Farah Palmer Cup. It is, you know, the standard has gone down because we have seen the best player, Pasikala, who was for Hawke's Bay, you know, most clean breaks, most defenders beaten out of anyone last year. Probably one of the reasons why they went up into the Premiership. now playing in the NRLW, and she's getting paid to play there. Wouldn't have been paid playing for the Tui.
So not all the Black Ferns are playing in this competition. All the Black Fern Sevens, we saw Ruby Tui come back from the USA. That's another competition that is taking out these star players. How do you get them back into the Farah Palmer Cup so that you have people wanting to watch these teams?
It's the disparity thing as well. You know, you look at Taranaki, you know, they've conceded something like 250 points this year. The next team down is 120. It's really hard to, you know, come into a competition like that because, yes, you are playing a good game every now and then, but there's been some games where it's, you know, 84-0 this year. That's not good for anyone in the game, despite being a Black Fern. You know, if you're a Black Fern coming up against a team that's struggling, you're almost going to feel bad, you know, scoring four tries against a team like that, you know, with schoolgirls, because that's the other thing. There's so many schoolgirls in the competition. What does that say about the club comps?
But if they don't play, where do they play and get their experience? Yeah. Because they're not in a position where they're going to move province, are they? And a lot of them, aren't they? This is their one and opportunity to play provincial rugby. But to your point, it's the fact that if it's reflective of your union, it's reflective of your union. You know, and I agree with you. It's the fact that's what the community game is supposed to be. You're supposed to play club rugby to earn the right to play for your province, right? Yeah. If you're doing that, then surely.
Yeah, look, I think female sport worldwide is amazing. Look at the FIFA Women's World Cup. Amazing level of sport. I think the female World Cup last year was a success, but possibly we weren't ready from a structure or competition point of view. What I don't want, especially the women's game doing, is following the men's game when we already know it's not fit for purpose. So do we need to think outside the square on how we do the female game? I think we need to change the male game as it is, especially in NPC. So we maybe need to think a little bit differently. Are those, I think I've asked this before and I might not have got a reply, but the girls that have gone to play rugby league can come back?
I mean, they had to probably have been named earlier in those squads, and the seasons run concurrently, so...
But they can come back to rugby?
They can come back to rugby. Like, look, we've got, you know, Vaha Kolo. So she was a Kiwi Fern just last year. Now she's a Black Fern. So the rules seem to be different with the women as well. You know, we saw that
Kyle
when...
Nathan Wong's playing. Exactly. NRLW and will come back and get a shirt and play sevens.
Yeah, exactly.
Can I ask you this then, right? And it's easy to look at the negative sometime. Mm. When we get to the business end, who's it going to be? Like, because the quality of those teams will be really high, very much like the NPC.
Absolutely.
You know, when you start getting, you ask Super Rugby sides versus Super Rugby sides.
Yeah.
So when you look at it right now, who have been the standouts?
Oh, you can't go past Canterbury and Waikato. They always have a strong team, but that's because they have a consistent team. Because they've invested in the grassroots, they've got really strong club competitions. But Auckland are a surprise package. They've got a lot of youngsters, but, man, Sylvia Brunt was out the gate on Friday. She was insane. I haven't seen anyone, you know, pull that kind of stats up. She had 22 carries. She had 11 defenders beaten.
Right?
Oh, 100%. You know, she's 19 years old, won a Rugby World Cup when she was just 18. And, you know, you've got those kind of players playing in the competition. And the good thing about the Farah Palmer Cup is you actually do have people just wanting to try stuff. You know, the game today, Tasman...
Oi! What about that, Conan?
I know.
Is that a red card?
No, it wasn't.
Play
it
on.
Wasn't
play
even
on,
a penalty. But, you know, like, Tasman game, they brought in their left winger. They said, number eight, get out into the back line. The left winger scored off a five-metre scrum because you're really innovative in that Farah Palmer Cup because you can be, you know. It's not like playing in Super Rugby Opiki where it's so structured. So that is the positive about this competition is you're still seeing these young superstars. You know, that's that girl Solomona. She scored seven tries this season in three games and no one had heard of her before this. So it's still serving a purpose. We're still finding talent, but it's a bit of a gap between the good and the not so good.
So that's the FPC and who you think is going to be at the top. What about the NPC? Is JK's Auckland anywhere near the top this season?
Hey, well, look...
Seventh at the moment.
Yes.
Shocking.
They lost to Tasman, but how good was Tasman because of that man right there, Levi Olmua? He was just...
Well,
beating defenders like nothing. Poor Harry Plummer had a nightmare trying to contain him, ran it straight a few times. But look, Auckland, for a team full of Super Rugby stars, they really cannot seem to gel really well, which is really interesting. But I think at the end of the season, I'm going to be bold and say Taranaki's going to be up in that top four because they're 3-from-3 this year in a storm week. Last year they only won 3 games in total. We're only in round 2. So keep an eye out on Taranaki. I'm backing them.
That's us. The big calls have been made. Thank you so much for joining us. Enjoy your evening as well. And we'll see you next week. That is us on The Breakdown. Ka kite anō.